Thank you.
Sir, you are muted, sir. Right, sir,
Sandeep, we can let everyone in and start. And on behalf of Echo India, I'm Dr. Kumud Rai, Chair Echo India. Welcome everyone. And we have the one of the best known persons in the country, Mr. IAS Chahal. And we're privileged to have him. Over to you, Sandeep.
Thank you, sir. Very warm welcome and good evening to all the leaders, those who have joined today, all my healthcare professionals from the nooks and corners of the country. Today, if you see that the devastating second wave of COVID in India appears to have turned a corner, and with daily COVID-19 cases registering a constant decline, the deadly second wave of COVID in India is receding. India recorded a single day rise of 60,471 new coronavirus infections in the last 24 hours, the lowest in 75 days. With this, the cumulative count of cases has now gone up to 2.95 crores. The number of people are also getting recuperated from the disease in a big way. As India battles this huge crisis, we at Echo India deeply value that as Extension for Community Health Outcome, the project which started from in 2003 under the leadership of Professor Sanjeev Arora, and then it has taken up a big shape all across globe. Now it is more than in 140 countries, and we have set up a trust in India also known as Echo India Trust. On behalf of Echo India Trust, we really deeply value the role of educational webinar series. And the purpose is the role of everyone, especially the healthcare workforce, to combat this growing burden as we fight this pandemic together. We are very happy to have this series continuing. And today is the 14th session of the series going on. Countries across the world are pulling together to combat the spread of novel coronavirus, and many international borders have been shut, flight restrictions imposed, and cities have gone into lockdown. In the midst of this, the need of innovative strategies and products to identify and mitigate the contagion is urgent. In India, this responsibility is being not only being shared by the government, but also the large manufacturing companies, those who are producing the PPE kits, ventilators, but also by various startups, NGOs, philanthropic organizations, community leaders, and individuals as well. Many states, cities, and corporations have adopted innovative, multi-pronged strategies and approaches to combat COVID-19. Mm-hmm. And in that, Mumbai model of fight against COVID pandemic is unique of its kind in the world. It consists of 24 originally conceived, designed, and successfully implemented initiatives such as Mission Dharavi, Mission Save Lives, My Life, My Responsibility, Chase the Virus Policy, Chase the Patient Policy. And in this, let me tell you that there was a great leader who has created this particular battle to fight in Mumbai in a very, very big way. And that is none other than but Shri IAS Chahal, sir. Very good evening, IAS Chahal, sir, to join us and give us this particular opportunity. Mumbai COVID model was appreciated by the Honorable Supreme Court of India and received accolades from WHO, Government of India, World Bank, ILO, RBI, various international print electronic medias also. On behalf of Echo India, today, this particular series, we want to learn from you and we want to get an update from you that how, as a leader, with the help of the various colleagues, how you have taken up this particular battle and how you have won this battle and how you're sustaining the things. Mr. Chahal is from the Indian Administrative Services and currently the Municipal Commissioner of Municipal Corporation of Greater Mumbai. He has been the Principal Secretary to the Urban Development Department, Government of Maharashtra, Principal Secretary of Water Resources Department, Government of Maharashtra, among many other positions of responsibility. Sir has received several awards for his work, including a letter of appreciation from Chief Secretary of Maharashtra, Maharashtra of the Year Award, Mumbai Ratna Award, Citizen of Mumbai Award, COVID Crusader Award, National Water Award, and various awards, you name the things, accolades which he has received nationally and internationally. We are lucky to have Shri IAS Chahal along with us today. To start the session, we have two eminent moderators with us, and they are none other than, but one is Professor Dr. S. Natarajan. Professor Dr. S. Natarajan is the eminent Padma Shri awardee and has been a vitreoretinal surgeon since 1984. He has been the president of Teleophthalmic Society of India, Shankara Netralaya Alumni. Previously, he has been president of VRSI, MOS, OTSI. He is the worldwide secretary general of GEGC Board of Trustee of ICO. Dr. Natarajan is a Guinness World Record holder for screening the maximum number of diabetic retinopathy cases in the urban Salam Dharavi. And there is a good news to share with all of you that yesterday you must have seen in the Times of India that Dharavi, known as Asia's largest slum, which didn't report even a single COVID-19 case over the last 24 hours for the first time since Feb 2. It has been a population of about 10 lakhs packed within an area of 2.1 square kilometer. And it is a clear indicator that Mumbai is recovering well. Credits goes to none other than but the Mumbai makers and the Mumbai leaders like Mr. Chahal and all other policymakers, those who have taken this fight in a very big way. We have another very eminent guest moderator with us, and that is none other than but our own founder chairman, Dr. Kannal Kumud Rai. Dr. Kannal Kumud Rai is the founder chairman of Eco Trust and is the director of vascular surgery at the Max Super Specialty Hospital, Saket, New Delhi. He held several prestigious appointments while serving for 25 years in Indian Army, and these included head of the Department of Vascular Surgery at the flagship Army Research and Referral Hospital, New Delhi, and professor of surgery at AFMC Pune. He was awarded the Sena Medal by the President of India for his dedicated services of highest order during the Kargil War. He is also the recipient of Seva Ratan Award for Public Service by Sevatran Hospital, Jaipur. Dr. Rai is a visiting fellow at Northwestern University, Chicago, as well as the Cleveland Clinic. He has multiple publications and contributed 8 chapters in the books and was the guest editor for the special issue on vascular surgery for the Indian Journal of Surgery. On behalf of Eco India, on behalf of our Eco family, we are really grateful and thankful to you, Chahal sir, for joining hands with us and giving. And we are open, we are looking forward to learn from you that what innovations, what are the things which you have adopted and which has created a greater impact. I'm really thankful to the SBI Foundation to provide us the grant to run this educational series, because through their help, we are continuing this series since last month, and today is the 14th session, and we have very eminent person like you with us. On behalf of Eco India, very grateful and thankful to you. Handing over to Dr. Kumud Rai sir and Dr. Natarajan to take the lead. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Sandeep Balla, for this, and I have a short presentation to introduce what we are doing in Mumbai along with our commissioner. So I actually wanted to tell that all the doctors in Mumbai are grateful to our commissioner Chahal sir, and apart from person where every doctor and everybody in Mumbai are proud of him. And that's why I wanted to say what we are, as doctors, we are doing. A short presentation just to tell innovative approach to healthcare and COVID-19. So the corona effect changed many aspects of eye healthcare delivery. I being an eye doctor, I wanted to talk about ophthalmology, and I'm the immediate past president of All India Ophthalmic Society. War-like preparation required on healthcare front. You will shortly see what Mr. Chahal has done for in Mumbai, where the entire world is looking at him. We had outpatient management, inpatient management, and healthcare infrastructure, infection management and control team. Infection management and control should be prioritized at every eye hospital or facility to minimize risk for patients and staff. And our outpatient management, the physical distancing, even if patient is asymptomatic, reduced wait time, telemedicine, and AI-based eye care delivery to reduce non-urgent appointment, limiting close physical contact is key to helping reduce the spread of the disease. So I, as a president of the Organized Medicine and Academic Guild, use this SMSV, S for sanitization, M for mask, S for physical distancing, and V for vaccination. So please sanitize your hands, please wear mask and social distancing. And so the main thing is vaccine. I think our hospital infrastructure management, what did we do to minimize the risk? Because I want everybody to do this, whether it's an organization or hospital, hand sanitizer, non-contact thermal scanning, where plastic shields are between the patient and the doctor and the instrument, and keep cleaning all the time. We can spend money to do that. And then you use PPE to examine. And then while operating, also wearing the PPE, I wear a 3D glass and do a 3D surgery. And you can see that this is all the operation theater setup. So idea, we are with the patient for a long time. So reduce number of clinic visits by having existing stable patients, teleophthalmic video consultation. For existing patient undergoing injection, counsel the patient to be prepared for getting an injection on the same day of consultation. Reduce number of visits, reduce cost to patient and hospital, and reduce risk of COVID-19 transmission by limiting gathering of patients. and teleophthalmology and correct patients need and retinal surgery with all precaution. And AI, we are using AI for screening, diagnosing and covering a large population in short time using machines and smartphones, and to avoid person-to-person contact of health workers with the population, and specifically not to use the precious doctors to do the screening. And here we have non-technical person doing this, and that's where we are working in Dharavi for the last 25 years. The Aditya Jyoti Foundation for Twinkling Little Eyes. The name was given by Dr. Abdul Kalam. And thanks to our Mr. Chahal sir, you can see an unassuming personality here. I like this Brihanmumbai Municipal Corporation symbol, as well as the building, which is a royal building where sir sits. Unfortunately, due to COVID, I'm not able to go. I want to go and enjoy having tea with him. The Brihanmumbai Corporation Commissioner, Mr. Iqbal Singh Chahal, and 1989 batch IAS officer, is now being celebrated across the board for his handling of COVID-19 crisis in Mumbai a year after he took over. I'm happy. I know him before, and I have heard of him even from Mr. Sushil Kumar Shinde, the former Home Minister, when sir was working in Government of India. Mr. Chahal was awarded the Lokmat, the Maharashtrian of the Year 2021 award, for which as one of the panelists with the board by Union Minister Nirmala Sitharaman earlier this year, and praised for right approach and judicious use of resources. Mr. Iqbal Singh Chahal is which we know that currently the BMC Commissioner. Mr. Chahal was served at the Government of Maharashtra and India in various capacity. In his initial career, he was Collector of Thane and Aurangabad districts. Later on, he was Joint Secretary in Ministry of Home Affairs, Ministry of Women and Child Development, and Ministry of Panchayat Raj. Following that, he was also Principal Secretary in Water Resources Department and Urban Development Department of Maharashtra. So I just want to tell what we are working with our BMC, thanks to Mr. Chahal and Dr. Daksha Shah, Dr. Mangala Gumare, Dr. Chiplunkar, where we have signed this MOU, Aditya Jyoti Foundation for Twinkle Little Eyes, with MCGM, that is Mumbai Corporation of Greater Mumbai, for screening free diabetic retinopathy screening in urban population of Mumbai. This is a project began with the Mumbai Municipal Corporation in 2018, and so far total number of patients screened with the BMC is about 2,600. There are total of 150 diagnosed with diabetic retinopathy, and we are doing free treatment for them. So the MOU highlights are free screening of population, referral to higher center for fluorescein angiography, OCT, free laser, surgical management for free at municipal center. I'm glad they are under the municipal commissioner, the Nair Hospital and Sion Hospital are doing excellent vitreoretinal surgery. And I was also an honorary visiting in Sion. And I would like to, I think my age is probably allowed me, asked me to retire, I think, but I'm not sure. I'm ready to do free surgeries even now, whenever the commissioner wants, and free annual checkup for diabetes, research and publication with data retrieved from screening. So this is the MOU signed by Dr. Mangala Kumare, Dr. Daksha Shah, and Dr. Chiplunkar on behalf of the Brihanmumbai Corporation and myself as a managing trustee. I'm glad to say I'm in Mumbai for 33 years. We have touched 8 million people out of 21 million people, but Mr. Chahal has touched in 1 year all the 23 million people of Mumbai and all the floating population. We have done 3,400 free screening camps in Mumbai. We give a card to each patient, and nobody knows me. I'm glad that Dr. Abdul Kalam asked me to do that. And this is what we have done: 2,504 diabetics in 63 municipal dispensaries, 455 suspected, and 152 were found to have retinal changes, 221 had cataract, which and other morbidities. I'm glad the ophthalmology department and municipal corporation is doing very well. And this is the recent camp in one of the Brihanmumbai Mahanagarpalika clinic, where I went to meet the doctor, and you can see the doctor in white coat. And he's an eighth pass boy, Nilesh, who's like this. We have trained illiterate people, and we are trying to work with the Skill Development Corporation, where we can give them job and handle this mobile phone and use the camera to take the retinal photograph. And this is in the clinic, which was done last week. And we also came in the Guinness World of Record by doing it in the Chan. And I also went and showed to the governor on World Diabetes Day. This is a short video which shows. Okay. So this any boy can do the retina photographs like this, and then you can see that. So they can focus the pupil and then take it. That's a photograph of the optic nerve and retina. If you have seen Sundar Pichai said, we can diagnose ischemic heart disease using the AI. But at present, we are ahead of Google. We are the first in the world to use the Medios offline AI, and we can apply the AI like this, what you see here. This is done by a boy who's not even a school dropout, where the blue marks the abnormality of retina, and we can get, and thanks to the foresight of Brihanmumbai Corporation, where we have published this in JAMA Ophthalmology. And I think we can analyze the optic nerve, we can analyze the blood vessel, and also diagnose ischemic heart disease, Alzheimer, and several others. And this is one of the happy patients in the Dharavi. We also have a research wing. We have tied up with and this is a BMC's pilot study using AI with smartphone. And then you can see the POI and Amazon report soon. Sorry, AI smartphones used to detect diabetic retinopathy in civic run dispensaries. AI shows promise in screening diabetic retinopathy. A study finds place in the Journal of American Medical Association. All thanks to BMC, and that's what the BMC is in JAMA, and this is there in the recent Lokmat. So this is a sustainable screening solution for community screening. I hope I can screen every citizen in Mumbai and every citizen in India screening through teleophthalmology for preventing blindness. So with this, I'm going to ask questions. So I want to say that Mr. Chahal looks like Swami Vivekananda. Take up one idea, make that one idea your life, think of it, dream of it, live on that idea, let the brain, muscles, nerves, every part of your body be full of that idea, and just leave every other idea alone, and this is the way to success. And this is what Mr. Chahal has done. And I wanted to say that with this, sir, I know we took a long time to introduce you. We have consumed 17 minutes, but many of us have seen your YouTube videos. Recently, I'm seeing the Forbes thing. So the first question is, I'm sure everybody has asked you the same question. I saw that in Mr. Shekhar Gupta or even the Router, everybody. So what is that which gave you that out of the box thinking when you took over as the, well, I know you already, so I'm prejudiced that way that you are a great bureaucrat and will do. But what is that which made you think that when you are posted as the commissioner and with your past experience, when they already people were talking Bombay is bad and that they're terrible, and people used to call me and how are you living there? I said, no, I love Bombay. So I love Mumbai. So that way, what is that which has the drive which made you do this, and you still look young and you're looking healthy and you're spreading that positivity?
First of all, at the outset, I would thank Dr. Natarajan and Eco India for providing this opportunity today to present our Mumbai's case before eminent audience. So I thank you from my heart. Now coming to the question, you know, on the 8th of May 2020 last year, when the government of Maharashtra decided to post me as the municipal commissioner, and I joined around 7 p.m. in the evening. Since COVID first case came up in mid-March, so March, April, and the first week of May, Mumbai had become a hotspot in the country, primarily because between 1st February and 22nd March, when the last flight arrived from international borders, 1.7 lakh passengers had got down in Mumbai airport. And they carried this virus from Europe, from Middle East, from all over the world in a big way. And we were the first to get affected by this imported virus of COVID. And then it spread like a wildfire. And in the first week of May, the Dharavi was on fire. We were getting 300 cases a day. And the day I joined, I remember that day on the 7th of May in the morning, we had three dead bodies on the road, one in Dadar on a footpath, one in auto rickshaw driver lying dead in his auto rickshaw, and third, a man who was rushing from Dharavi, I would say, to Sion Hospital because he was gasping for breath. He died on the road divider, and his dead body was found there. So when I took over at 7 in the evening, I was fairly aware what was happening because whole March, April, as a principal secretary of urban development, I was monitoring the parameters of COVID on behalf of the government of Maharashtra. 27 municipal corporations, 36 collectorates, but I was just data collecting person. And so I knew fairly well how things are unfortunately unfolding. And that after I took over, I must I always say this, that as a bureaucrat, you always report back to our boss, our honorable chief minister, that I said I would take on over. And he uttered one sentence which put fire in my belly. And I said, sir, I have just taken over. It was about 7:05. And he said, like, Chahal, you remember, a lot of people told me that generals are never changed during war. When a war is happening, either the general is replaced before the war, or if you lose the war, the general gets changed after the war, like it happened in 1962 Indochina thing. So he said, this is the first time I general is being changed during middle of the war. And he said, a lot of people have been talking to me since morning when I shared with the top political personalities that there's going to be change here. So they said that, why are you changing general during middle of the war? And he said, look, Chahal, I have done it now. And remember one thing, if you succeed, success will be all yours. Look at the greatness of that man, Honorable Shri Uddhav Thackeray, sir. Normally politicians don't talk like that. And he said, if you fail, it'll be all my failure. But the world will say that I took a wrong decision, and that is why things have failed because of my main one decision. Normally politicians say that if you succeed, success will be mine. If you fail, failure will be yours, but the other way around. And I suddenly, after his phone call, I closed my eyes for a few minutes. I said, now come what may, I have to succeed. I have no other option. And I said, even at the risk of my life, I'm going to do it. And after that, when the meeting started, immediately after that, within 5-10 minutes at 7:15, I had already told around 5:30 that I'm coming to join at 7, and I need my core team in my meeting hall next to my chamber. So we were 120 of us. Those days, nobody was meeting in person. Everybody was happening on Zoom. But my 24 ward officers, 7 deputy commissioners, joint commissioners, additional commissioners, 24 medical officers, their zonal level officers, we 120 people, we gathered in one single hall for 5 hours. I said, doesn't matter, let us face it. And within half an hour of joining, it came out of mouth while speaking. I said, we'll have to chase this virus. So everybody was taken by surprise that how do you chase this invisible enemy? So I told them, look, first of all, I'm going to give option to my team that anybody wants to opt out, somebody who's comorbid, somebody who's afraid that something will happen to him, he has 24 hours time to opt out and there'll be no compulsion. But once you have opted in, then you have to face and you have to chase this virus. And very next morning, at 9 o'clock in the morning, I, to have demonstration effect to my 100,000 people, I got into PPE kit. I spent 53 minutes in COVID ICU of Nair. There are 45 patients. I spoke to almost 30 of them who were not on ventilators, who could speak. And then I spoke to every ward boy, every nurse, every doctor there. Right, and I shared my phone numbers with them. I said, if you have any problem, you can call me 24/7. I'll stand behind you people like rock. And from there, after having spent 53 minutes in ICU COVID, I went straight to Dharavi. And we did a 5-kilometer march in containment zone of Mukund Nagar. And we entered toilets. I made it a point that I'll enter the last seat of the public toilet. The public toilet has 20 seats. I would enter the slum houses. I would enter other places, the lanes and by lanes, just to assure my team that this virus is nothing. It's not going to do anything to us as long as we take precautions and unless we take proper care. And now, how did chase this virus happen? We started immediately in the right earnest. Once I entered the slums, my team naturally had no option. So we entered the slum homes. We would test a person. Somebody found positive. 15 of his family members and neighbors were forcibly picked up, put in buses. We requisitioned 187 hotels, 48,000 rooms, 3-star, 4-star hotels. We shifted them in these hotels, 48,000 beds. We kept them for 10 days to disconnect from the virus. And We said if they develop symptoms in 10 days time, they'll move to hospitals. If they don't develop symptoms on day 10, they'll be tested and brought back to their sanitized homes. This was number one step in chase the virus. Number two, we said each public toilet was being shared by more than 200 people. And we had 2,300 containment zones those days, which means for a population of 4,000 per containment zone, we virtually had 1.2 crore people in the containment zone. But look at the havoc it was creating. And the New York Times was saying that Mumbai, there'll be thousands of deaths on the roads and things, everything is going to go out of control. We didn't bother. We said we are going to do it. And then number two, I said, these public toilets where you have 20 seats, 25 seats, and every few hours they come in batches, 200 people share one public toilet. I went to the last seat. I stood there for 20 seconds, 25 seconds in the last seat to tell my team there's nothing to worry. And then I said, instead of sanitizing these washrooms once in 24 hours, which has been happening for the last 50 years in slums, we will start sanitizing them 5 times in a day. Almost every 2-3 hours, they'll be sanitized. So when the next batch comes, they'll get a sanitized bathroom toilet to use it. So we start. After that, even today also, we spent crores of rupees, and every single toilet seat in slums of Mumbai, hundreds of them, they are being sanitized 5 times in a day. And I have created community leaders there. I've said it doesn't happen directly, you have to inform me. We have spent crores of rupees, and because of this, last year, we had only one malaria death in entire Mumbai. We had zero dengue death. Even the monsoon-related diseases, they just vanished because the areas had become so sanitized and so clean. Number three, we created a community leader concept. 2,300 containment zone, each would have one community leader and the eligibility was he should be living with his family for years together in that containment zone. He can't be outsider. We gave one smartphone to each of them. We put dozens of teachers in ward war rooms, and these teachers were told to talk to these community leaders and ask them 7 questions every time. They were given functions. And I said, if they don't call, and if a community leader calls and they don't pick up the phone, then the next phone should come to commissioner. And if the phone comes to commissioner from a community leader, the ward officers will face the music then. So I said, number one, they will give us feedback to our ward war rooms, whether our officers, whether our health officials are entering the slum homes or not, doing the testing or not, taking COVID people out or not, whether 5 times in a day the toilets are getting sanitized or not. Because 4,000 population, you hardly had 2 public toilets and 3 public toilets in 1 containment zone. Then there are 1,500 doctors, RMPs, who have shut their shutters in standalone shops. And they were too afraid to open even for non-COVID works. We started giving them 2 PP kits per day, one for him and one for assistants, 7 days advance quota, 14 PP kits. Those is costing 2,000 rupees, 1 PP kit. 1,500 people, we said, you collect your this weekly quota in advance from ward war room, and please open your shutters. You sit in PP kits with your assistant, nothing is going to happen to you. So this community leader was supposed to give us feedback whether they are operating or not, because they shouldn't take 28,000 rupees of PP kits and then not function. And in a few days, we had hundreds of these shutters up, and people started getting treatment for non-COVID issues like diarrhea or some headache or some other problem they had. So this was also being reported by community leader. Then the community leader was told that you let us know if any comorbid person is left behind by our health teams. By mistake, we'll come and pick him up also. Then those days, we are distributing 900,000 food packets on a day. And the quality of food was monitored by these community leaders. So the system of community leaders' feedback, it was game changer for slums. And we started moving 30,000 people from slums named as high-risk contacts to these hotels. First week, we used force. But when the people landed up in 4-star hotels with free boarding and lodging for 10 days, they were too happy to move out. And after that, there was no force required. They would move of their own. We moved 1.45 lakh people in the first 5 weeks. And this started happening on 11th or 12th of May. And I remember on the 13th of July, the WHO Director General Tedros came on in public press conference and said the Ravi is under control. So it happened in just 2 months. And same concept was used in each and every slum of Mumbai. And the worst period of my life was 8th May to 8th June. I'll tell you, give you various reasons why it was the worst period of my lifetime. What used to happen that those days, we would get about 1,500 positives every day. And these test reports would be slapped on the patient through an email or a SMS by the testing labs. And around 7 p.m., the doctors would be in tremendous fatigue, who have to load them beds. Everybody was packing to go home, and suddenly the 1,500 list comes. And the moment a patient would get a positive list, he would start panicking at late in the evening. He would start calling up his politician friends, his IAS officer friends, his doctor friends, other influential people, rich people of the city to get him a bed. One person would generate at least 10 phone calls, and this 1,500 people could generate 15,000 phone calls. And poor 30-line central control room would collapse immediately by 8:30. And then the electronic media will take over that Mumbai, the control room is down, beds are not available. And those days, we didn't have a dashboard. The guy sitting in a control room would pick up the phone, ring up a hospital, that do you have a bed? And the clerk there says that no bed is available, the end of the story. So this is how we were functioning in a pandemic. So when media would take over, I would start getting calls from Government of India, from Government of Maharashtra. And supposing if I don't pick up the phone, finally the Honorable CM would call me that beds are not available, control room is not responding. So this was a harrowing experience, starting at 7:38 p.m. and go till past midnight. Secondly, we had only 3,700 beds available with BMC and 424 ICU. I remember that day we had all BMC hospitals put together, KM, Nair, Sion, Seven Hill, Cooper, HBT, and 13 peripheral hospitals. And today we have 100,000 beds, out of which 23,000 are pure hospital beds with ICUs, with ventilators, and with 70% oxygen beds. 30,000 of the, and this 23,000 are going to come 30,000 very soon by 15th of July. We have 48,000 CCC1, 24,000 CCC2. CCC1 COVID care center, we put high risk contacts. CCC2, we put asymptomatic poor patients who do not have an independent toilet in the home. We get them to CCC2 COVID care center 2, and they're asymptomatic positive put together. If you add all this, this virtually become 100,000 beds. We came from 3,700 beds that time. Then next issue was this issue of shortage of beds, no dashboard. Then we had very limited number of testing labs because those days when the pandemic hit us, Mumbai had only Kusturba and Pune had only Naidu. We started with 2 labs. Today we have more than 100 labs. So those days, there was the test reports wouldn't come on time. I remember the 4th of April test reports had come on 22nd April. By the time the patient had died, whose swab was taken, his high risk contacts had passed away. So situation was horrible. So then your stakeholders, naturally, they would get a lot of opportunity to punch us and to hit back at us that nothing is happening, the world is collapsing. So I remember on the 23rd or 24th of May, I told my team, I said, I cannot function like this. Either I'll vacate this chair or something has to change. And again, it suddenly, it was impromptu, which came out of my, I said, we'll have to abolish this control. So my officers told me, sir, we are playing with fire, that we have one small control room, and with that also we abolish, there'll be chaos in the city. I said, listen to me, what I'm saying. I said, we need to go for a decentralized fight. We have 24 wards. Each ward will have one war room. Each war room will have 10 ambulances, 10 doctors, 10 medical teams, 10 telephone operators, 10 teachers, and they'll have 10 dashboards. And we'll create all of these in the next few days. In fact, the work had already started. So I said, each ward will become independent Mumbai, except the common dashboard. The ambulance will not go out of the area. The doctors will function there only. So we suddenly, when it was announced, one top option leader rang me. He said, Mr. Chahal, you are playing with fire. and we will not allow this to happen, that you are abolishing the control room. I said, sir, you give me 15 days. In 15 days time, if you don't see alternate mechanism working, then you call me. And I'm happy to say that till today, he has not called me back. So then in those days, the online dashboard came, then war rooms came, then we needed 1,000 doctors. I started SMS campaign, WhatsApp campaign, because I was medical agent secretary, Government of Maharashtra in 2011, 12, 13. I knew we have 55 medical colleges. We have 11,000 interns of MBBS sitting home in lockdown those days, doing nothing, getting only 11,000 honorarium or stipend. So Dr. Mohan Joshi, my dean then of Nair Hospital, now in Sion, I told him to launch SMS campaign, and we got 1,100 of them. We said, we'll give you 50,000 rupees stipend. We'll put you in a five-star hotel, walking distance from the ward war room, free boarding and lodging. This 50,000 will be pocket money, and we'll give you non-COVID work air-conditioned environment. 1,100 boys and girls, 19, 20, 21 joined us. They continue with us now also. Like, for example, somebody in Ju was in JW Marriott, 500 meters, 200 meters from the ward war room. Somebody in A ward was at Taj Mahal Hotel. These young boys and girls from tribal areas, rural areas, backward communities, they worked wonders. And they were so enthusiastic, they were afraid of losing their assignment. So they worked with such a great vigor that I really salute them. And then we needed 24 wards, we needed 240 doctors in one shift, because 10 dashboards we manned. 24, and then three shifts, 720 doctors, and then reserves, we needed 1,000 of them. And we got them in just about 5 days. And then we went to IIT Mumbai, we got a real-time, online, integrated dashboard made. One very important thing, which hasn't happened anywhere in the world till now, the private-public hospitals model of Mumbai. I remember on the 18th of May, there was a very scathing report in New York Times. I took a printout and invited 35 CEOs of top major hospitals of Mumbai. And when the meeting started, I just read out the news item to them. And the news item said that Mumbai was trying to boast of being the medical tourism in South Asia after Singapore. And today, dead bodies are on the roads. And they said that it's the beginning of the problem. And they said that Mumbai's reputation of being a health and good health city was going to be crushed in the next few days. So I told these CEOs of these hospitals, if your reputation goes away, it won't come back for decades together. And the loss to you will be in thousands of crores, because those days, people from African countries, Middle East, had started coming to Mumbai hospitals for angioplasty, bypass surgery, and many other ailments because of cheaper option they had than the West and the North America. So they said, sir, what do you want us to do? I said, look, you take a hit of a few hundred crores for the next 1 or 2 years, but this is going to long haul, but you will make thousands of crores in the longer run by protecting your reputation. And I said, you hand over 100% of ICU to me. You hand over 80% of your COVID beds to me. You don't allot them, I'll allot them. And at government rate, 4,000 rupees per bed, whether it's a Beach Candy or Nanavati or Lilavati, any hospital. I said, if you accept my proposal, we'll join hands and we will resurrect our reputation, and we'll prove to the world that Mumbai has a very robust health system. And fortunately, they agreed. And suddenly, my dashboard of 3,700 beds went to 10,000, because we got 6,000 beds in private hospital, including we got something like 600 ICU from them. Today, it's the figure is 9,000. And this joining of hands, which continues right now also when I'm talking to you, the private hospitals have taken a hit of 1,000 crores, but still there is a zero complaint. They are serving with a smile. On my dashboard today, I have 182 hospitals, 23,000 beds, out of which 142 are private hospitals. And they're all allotting beds at 4,000 rupees. They all have my municipal auditors sitting on their admission counters. My municipal auditors, they vet the bill. Only after the bill is approved by my municipal auditor, only then the bill is released to the payment a patient on discharge. So there's no question of any complaint coming. In second wave, we had 400,000 cumulative COVID positive patients, not even a single complaint of overcharging. Maybe the only city in the country. where we have this kind of such a very harmonious relationship in public and private hospitals, and they are really serving. I salute them for this. And we couldn't make this model successful even in the neighboring cities of Maharashtra, forget about the rest of the country. The kind of service which private hospitals and doctors are providing us is tremendous. So by on the 8th of June, when I said 8th of May and 8th of June last year, by 8th of June, we had dashboard ready, we had beds ready, we needed about 1,000 ambulances. Because if you give 10 ambulances to every ward war room 24/7, we need to park 240 ambulances there. We need to park ambulances in COVID care centers, in CCC1, CCC2 hospitals, another fleet of 50 ambulances to be kept ready at the main control room. So since I had conducted a lot of Lok Sabha, Vidhan Sabha elections during my 8 years as collectorship, so we knew how to get 1,000 vehicles in 2 to 3 days. So I told Transport Commissioner of Maharashtra, I said, I need 1,000 Innovas and Sumos in 3 days' time, requisitioned with drivers. And the drivers and the vehicles were too happy to join me because they were sitting home in lockdown doing earning nothing. We would pay them. So in just about 5 days, we got 800 of them. I just took them to our BMC workshop. We put an aluminum sheet between driver's compartment and the rest of the vehicle, and it became ambulance. We painted it the ambulance. Later on, I said, COVID patients don't need stretchers. They just need to sit in the ambulance for 20 minutes and they need to be taken to the nearest hospital. And if those people who may need stretchers, we took mini buses of BEST, which is a sister concern of BMC. And in 15 days' time, we converted 50 of these mini buses into stretcher type of ambulances. Suddenly, the number of ambulances went from 80 to 825 in about 10 days' time. So by the time we started war ward room, we had ambulances, we have a medical team because 15,000 health workers were there. We had doctors managing these 240 dashboards. We had deployed teachers for community leaders to interact with the containment zones. We had put telephone operators in every war ward room, had 30 MTNL lines functioning. So now next was the very courageous decision. It was such a, you know, In a pandemic like this, unless you take risk, unless you have risk appetite, nothing succeeds. Because it's a war and it's a question of life and death. Like an army, you should be ready to pick a bullet. Otherwise, you can't go to war. Here also, you should be ready to die if you have to succeed. So we on the 22nd of May, when this evening harassment was going on every day, of people ringing up, lines getting dropped, people not getting beds, they're being slapped with test positive reports, and panic in the entire city. I suddenly drafted an order. The order was that henceforth, no COVID positive patient shall get COVID positive report directly from the lab. It will not flow from the lab to the patient. Until today morning, and now right now when I'm talking to you, we're the only one city in the world. I repeat, we're the only one city in the world where the COVID positive report by order doesn't go from 56 labs of Mumbai today to a patient. And in fact, the order is that if we found that any report has gone directly, we'll cancel the license of the lab. Look at the risk involved there. We have handled 7,05,000 patients till now, 3.13 lakh in the first wave, and almost 4.02 lakh in the second wave. And the 700,000 odd reports came to BMC at midnight. And then we informed through our ward war rooms at 8 a.m. in the morning onwards that you are COVID positive. Even if one report had got missing and somebody would have passed away and his relatives would have sued me saying that they didn't have a COVID report in hand, they couldn't get treatment, they couldn't go to hospital, they couldn't get a COVID bed because Mr. Chahal didn't allow COVID report to come to us. This was a very risky decision and I knew the risk involved. But I said, we have such robust IT systems now and I'm sure and there is no human intervention. The line list comes from 56 labs in email on a software to us at midnight. and then system automatically splits this into 24 parts. It appears in dashboards. There's no reason why any name should disappear. And it didn't disappear till today. For example, if we get 1,000 names in a day, each dashboard would get about 40. Each ward warm gets 40, each dashboard gets 4 patients to handle. If we get 10,000 people in a day, each dashboard gets 40. Each ward warm gets 400 positives, and each dashboard gets 40. So out of those 40, if say 20, 25 are asymptomatic people for home quarantine, the moment you allot them 10, 12 beds, the list of 10,000 disappears. So I said, whether you get 1,000 cases or 5,000 cases or 10,000 cases or 24,000 cases, doesn't matter, because things are on autopilot now. And this is how we have 26 models all on autopilot today. And this was a very daring decision to pass an order in writing that the patient will not get positive report directly. The matter went to Honorable Supreme Court of India on the 19th of June last year. And people went to Supreme Court saying that we are violating the right of the patient to directly get report. So we went to Honorable Supreme Court. We showed them videos how our ward warms are functioning, that how our turnaround time is 16 hours only, whereas cities of India are not getting reports in 2 days, 3 days, 4 days. And I said, if we are providing them report through us within 24 hours maximum, so what is the problem? Even so, we could win the confidence on the Supreme Court also, and we carried on with that system. And I am really happy that our team, which is outstanding, I always say I salute my team, BMC. They have ensured that the 700,000 positive people whose reports came to us, we could inform each one of them. And till today, I say on record, there is not a single complaint through even unknown WhatsApp or message or any complaint to any political leader that somebody didn't get a report. Everybody has got it. So, but this risk has worked wonders, because what happens that now tomorrow, supposing if we get 1,000 cases in a day, and each war room gets about, say, 40 cases in a day, and out of 40, maybe you have to give a lot, 15 beds and 25 are home quarantine. So each one of these 15 would ask for a hospital bed. Our medical teams in PPE kits and ambulances start moving to their homes. And ward being a small territory, ambulance doesn't take more than 20 minutes to reach their home. So we go with, our medical teams go with the pulse oximeters. They go with they measure the temperature also. They check their comorbidity. And then they decide what category of bed is entitled to. Whether it's a minister, whether it's a slum dweller. Everybody is equal. There's a lot of social equity here. So the bed is allotted by calling up the ward war room by the medical team from his residence and announced at his residence that so-and-so bed in so-and-so hospital is allotted to you. So we allot beds at the residence. We virtually make that COVID positive patient captive, and we put him on the hospital bed in the same ambulance, and the hospitals have no role to play. They have no business to stop our ambulances or medical teams from entering. We directly go and put the patient on the bed. And then the medical team calls the ward war room saying the patient is not disposed of. So by 2 p.m., 2:30 p.m., the entire list of 10,000 disappears. But in this, our selfish interest is there. We're the biggest beneficiaries. Because otherwise, if this report would have been slapped on him directly through SMS or a email, he would have immediately picked up his car or a taxi and started roaming in the market, going from one hospital to another hospital, seeking for bed. And by the time he would have got bed in the evening, like it is happening in almost all cities of India. So he would have infected dozens of people and made them COVID positive. And next day, after a couple of days, they would have become our liability. So here we don't allow a COVID positive patient to infect even a single other person outside his home, because we pick him up and put him on the hospital bed in our ambulances. So ultimately, we are the beneficiaries, not the patient, by allotting bed to him at his residence. And I don't know any other city in the world which has this kind of system functioning. And we have till now handled 700,000 people. And those people who are asymptomatic positive, now even they would be really afraid that tomorrow if they develop a symptom, they may or may not get a bed, they may die. Those feelings do come to you. Now, this ward war rooms, these doctors, 720 of them in 24 hours, they were told that you will call up asymptomatic home quarantine people 5 times in a day and check their health, how they're feeling. And they will tell them that if they develop any symptom or they need any patient, treatment protocol or any information, they would be given. And on the third or fourth or fifth day, they develop a symptom, the same ambulance goes to the home, the symptom checked, bed allotted, and they're put in the hospital bed. So this ward war room started taking care of thousands of home quarantine people also. They were not left to fend for themselves. On 14th of April, 2021, we had 93,000 active cases in Mumbai. Out of the 93,000, almost 70,000 were home quarantined. But nobody was panicking because they had this hundreds of doctors to talk to and get satisfied with their queries. This system, I don't think, exists in many cities, and asymptomatic patients are left to fend for themselves. Especially when they develop symptoms, they need a hospital bed on second or third or fourth day. They don't get a priority because new lists have arrived. New people have arrived to be given beds. But in our system, they become an integral part of bed allotment. So then this war room was a game changer. And it started allotting beds, it had dashboard, it had doctors, it had ambulances, it had beds. Every doctor now has 182 hospitals, 23,000 beds right on his dashboard to be allotted. So this system, and then 24/7 functioning of the war room to take care of other people and their queries and things like that. So this 8th of May and 8th of June, all those happening. Number one, online dashboard. Number two, private hospital beds coming in. Number three, ambulances coming in. Number four, ward room starting up. Number five, then the very important issue. We had, when I joined, right on the 11th or 12th May, within 3 or 4 days of joining, I was told that one person known to me who had no kidneys, he was in permanent dialysis, he passed away in one of the hospitals. Why? Because he got allotted a bed where there was no dialysis facility. And I had no doubt in my mind that he has been declared as COVID death, but he has died because of non-dialysis. Because if you don't have kidneys, and if dialysis doesn't happen twice a week, or in some cases thrice a week, you will not survive. And if you are just randomly allotted a bed somewhere on the phone call that you go to Rajavadi somewhere and no, then he's isolated. He cannot be taken out because he would spread virus. So he would be in isolation. He would pass away in 3 or 4 or 5 days. So there, I got in touch with Dr. Bichu, who's an eminent nephrologist. And we created one system, coviddialysis.in. With the help of IIT Mumbai, a dashboard was created. And we found that the 10,000 people in Mumbai who are in permanent dialysis, they need dialysis at least twice a day, if not more. And every day, 15 to 20 of them would become COVID positive. So Dr. Bichu gathered 70 nephrologists of Mumbai who are looking after this 10,000 COVID positive patients. And we gave this Apex Kidney Foundation 103 technicians of BMC to be trained by them for 3 days only. They trained them and they spread to this 103 hospital those days. After that, this IIT Mumbai gave us a free gift of online portal for handling these patients. For example, if Mr. Chahal doesn't have kidneys and he becomes COVID positive, and I end up in one of the 103 hospitals, one of them those days, the moment I go on the bed, I would simply pick up my phone and call my family doctor that, sir, I have become COVID positive. He'll tell me to hold on. He'll open the dashboard portal. He'll say, Mr. Chahal, you are in HPT hospital, or you are in Shatabdi Kandivali hospital. There are 2 dialysis machines there. In machine number 2, tomorrow 2 slots available, 11 to 12, 4 to 5 p.m. Which one you want? I said, okay, give me 11 to 12. You will punch it. I'll get SMS. I'll show that SMS to my technician trained by this group in that hospital. Next morning, 11 o'clock, he'll come and pick me up from dialysis. And the system started rolling. Then equally, if not more important, suspected cases. supposing Mr. Chahal was going to Hinduja Hospital every day for his dialysis, and one day started coughing, the hospital shooed me away. He said, you are suspected case. We can't take your dialysis today. You first get a COVID negative report. Otherwise, you infect others also here. Now, what do you do? Those days, labs were limited. So if I go for a swab test, I may not get report for 2-3 days. And by the time I may die for non-dialysis. And I can't go to COVID dialysis also because I don't have a COVID report. So we created suspected hospitals for centers for them. One in Katkopar, one in Chembur. We said, and they were also on the portal. I said, if any hospital finds you suspected, don't wait for swab collection. You tell your family doctor, he'll get your slots on the same portal. You directly drive into those centers. They will do your dialysis. They will sanitize the machine and wait for the next patient to come. And even they started getting a copy of the SMS once the slot was allotted. So this way, we have handled 2150 such patients in the last 14 months. And I say with a sense of satisfaction, with a sense of pride, that not even one has passed away because of non-dialysis. Wow, this wonderful. Is unique in the world that we have a system like this, that that we didn't allow any person in our city to pass away because dialysis could not be conducted in any of the COVID hospitals. So this was also a very brave decision which we had taken. And this 4 weeks time, all these things were happening. Now, another important decision we took in those 30 days, we said that, I told my team, I said, look, we have limited labs. By end of May, we had 7-8 labs. This Metropolis, SR, they all had joined in and they got permissions. I said, we can't match the West. Those days in Germany, I remember they would have 50,000 or 60,000 tests every day. We had only 5,000 in a day. I said, a lot of people are going to die because you can't wait for tests to happen. Somebody's unwell, he's going to die. So by that time, thanks to Honorable CM, sir, Jumbo's hospital had come into existence by end of May, first week of June. And these Jumbo hospitals, we had 9,200 beds in 7 Jumbos, BKC, Dome, Burley, Nesco, Goregaon, then Daisar Cheknaka, Mullan Tolnaka, Richardson Kudas, all this Jumbos came up. I immediately earmarked 2,000 oxygen beds in the Jumbos as walk-in beds, walk-in patients. This is unique in the world again. We told the deans there, we said, these 2,000 oxygenated beds are meant for walk-in patients. And I said, then we went for aggressive publicity in print and electronic media and so ward war rooms also. We said in slums, whether you're rich or poor, anybody, if you are feeling unwell, if you are feeling breathless, if you have symptoms and lab has not taken your swab, you simply take an auto rickshaw, take a taxi, take an ambulance, walk into these 7 Jumbos. And deans will be waiting for you. Nobody shall be denied admission. They'll put on these suspected beds, 2,000 of them. And they will stabilize you by giving you oxygen. They will conduct your test. If you are found COVID positive, you will move to the COVID section. If you are found negative, you'll be stabilized and sent home after 2-3 days. We have saved 20,000 human lives through this suspected beds category. And today also, when I'm talking to you, we have almost 550 people lying on the suspected beds. It's a walk-in entry, free of cost. You don't even have to pay a single rupee. You take auto rickshaw, just land up on this air-conditioned, centrally air-conditioned Jumbo oxygenated bed. So otherwise, these 20,000 people who are feeling unwell, we would have needed lakhs of tests to be conducted to take them out. Because if you are, say, positive, you're 10%. You need to do 200,000 tests, and then you get this 20,000 suspected or confirmed people in that list. So we could create a system where without doing 2 lakh tests, we save this people. So this was a fantastic idea, which was very successfully implemented after having been conceived by us, that we will not allow any person to die just because his swab is not taken. And those days, initially in the month of May, I said, if it is taking 2 or 3 days for your report to come and you start feeling unwell, even if your swab is taken and your report is awaited, you rush to these suspected beds. So these are various models we did. Then another very modern model which nobody has emulated till today in the entire country. When I joined, I found that dozens of my colleagues had passed away in fight against COVID, especially our BEST bus drivers. They were transporting our doctors and frontline workers, health workers from hospital to the residences in lockdown and back. They would pick up COVID and ultimately pass away. Our chief engineers, deputy commissioners, ward officers have died. So, but they were not fitting into the government of India's insurance policy of 50 lakh rupees because that was meant only for health workers and frontline workers. The government of India said, your bus driver is not a frontline worker. I said, let us not argue. Within a few days of my joining, I passed an order, very brave order. I said, henceforth, if any of my colleagues, we have 1,08,000 employees in BMC. If anybody passes in COVID time because of this unfortunate situation, his family would get 50 lakh rupees compensation in cash from BMC funds. And no assistance from government of India, no assistance from government of Maharashtra, we'll fund this on our own. We have lost 301 of our colleagues till now, and we have distributed almost 150 crore rupees to the families and one employment to next of the kin in BMC. We sent a message that BMC is going to stand by you for the rest of your life with your family. So BMC has got 9,500 people COVID positive in the last 1 year, especially in the first wave. 90% of them were in the first wave, 10% in the second wave. And 300 plus fatalities. But today, my 100,000 people, I always say they can take a bullet for me. They are so loyal and they are so trustworthy to me. And that is why all this model succeeded, because I am just guiding them. They are fighting the war. I'm just leading it. So this 50 lakh compensation till today, I don't hear any other state government, any other city, any other corporation who has tried to copy us and give such compensation to their employees passing away, unfortunately, because of COVID. So these models, this compensation scheme, it put fire into the belly of our employees, and they felt assured that if something happens to them, their families will be looked after. They will not be, the BMC is going to stand by them. So this was another model which was highly successful. Then after that, we did number of other models. For example, we found that COVID people, especially going to isolation, would start staring death. They would be there for 2 weeks, 3 weeks, sitting idle whole day on the bed. If they are not on oxygen bed, if they're not on ICU bed, they'll start imagining that tomorrow they'll develop a symptom. Day after they will become breathless, they will hear stories. Then they will go to ICU. They may not come out. Families were worried what's happening to their patient because they were total seclusion, total isolation. You know, we bought 1.5 crore rupees of iPads, 600 iPads initially, and then a lot more. And in jumbos, for a ratio of five patients, we gave them one iPad. All the jumbos are made centrally Wi-Fi's. We said each of this patient, five patients can share one iPad and they can make video calls to their families. And they each patient can talk 1 hour, 2 hour nonstop to his family on a video call. The family feels reassured that the patient is hale and hearty. The patient feels reassured that his son, daughter, husband, wife, they're fine. And they would laugh, they would crack jokes. So that with this, suddenly thousands of people's mental issues, psychological issues disappeared because both sides felt reassured. This was such a simple exercise, but highly successful, and it continues today also. And we said, this is not a waste. When the COVID goes away, we'll distribute these iPads free of cost to our BMC school students. It's coming from slums and these areas, they can use for their education purpose, online education. So it's not a wasteful expenditure. So like this, we did a number of experiments, which has really helped us. And later on, when the first wave started ebbing out in September, October, things started coming under control. We launched a very novel scheme of My Family, My Responsibility. This was so unique. Mumbai had 3.5 million plus families. And our 15,000 health workers, we entered homes of this 3.5 million families, 99.1% coverage. Whether he was the rich of the rich, whether he's a top industrialist, whether he was the present honorable CM, whether he was the former honorable chief minister, whether he was a top doctor, we went to every home. We checked their oxygen levels for family members. We checked their temperature. We checked their comorbidity. 51,000 people were taken out comorbid and treated. And we went there armed with pamphlets. The pamphlet, the back side of the pamphlet, 12 inches by 6 inches, had the cell numbers of the telephone numbers of 24 ward war rooms as a directory to them. So every citizen gets a directory of ward war room numbers. Second, on the front side, we had do's and don'ts of COVID appropriate behavior. When the family members goes in the morning, a child goes for to play a game in a garden, or he goes to play with his friends. A husband goes to a job. A wife goes to shopping center or mall. Somebody travels in a public transport. What should be your behavior? What are the do's or don'ts? On public transport, don't talk too much. Keep your mouth shut. In office, maintain social distancing. Hey, when you go in the morning for a morning walk, please wear a mask. So those type of IEC happened through these pamphlets. And then we gave them a warning. We said, now, henceforth, from 1st of November, we'll start fining you 200 rupees if you don't wear a mask in public domain. And between 1st November and by the time the second wave came, in about 100 days, you'll be happy to know that we fined 27 lakh people, 2.7 million. We collected 54 crore rupees, and we also distributed one free mask to each one of them. And this 27 lakh people who got fined, they must have gone home, and a family of five, maybe 12 million people were sensitized that they should not come out without a mask. Other day, one correspondent, Washington Post lady, came to meet me about 2 months back when we were at the peak of the second wave. So in my office, I told her, I said, you're going back to the airport. Please keep on watching in your taxi how many people you find without mask on the roads. I said, they may have mask on their chin. They may have mask on their neck. They may have mask on their hand. But you let me know how many people you find without mask. She went to the airport. She said, Mr. Chahal, I was shocked. None. These people, a lot of people have masks on their chin or their neck, but nobody's stepping out of Mumbai these days without a mask. Even a laborer may have mask in his pocket. When we catch him, he takes it out from his pocket. But you hardly find a person without a mask. This 27 lakh people getting fined, this was a game changer. And I always say that in second wave, Pune's maximum number of COVID positive cases on a particular day touched 17,000. Delhi touched 27,000. Mumbai touched only 11,000. Virus was same, mutant was same. We didn't go to that level thanks to this mask culture in Mumbai. And now I keep on putting this again and again. I said, if everybody wears a mask, we can really literally avoid the onslaught of third wave. And recently when people say that it is spread more through the air, through the environment, mask has become more important than sanitizer also. So if somebody religiously wears a mask, I'm sure we can tide over this crisis in a better way. And we sustained this campaign of no mask, no entry, along with this My Family, My Responsibility. We hired 800 hoardings, 18 feet by 6 feet, and we painted them with no mask, no entry campaign, My Family, My Responsibility campaign. We printed 2 million stickers, 20 lakhs. Every office, every shop, every shopping mall, every private office, every bus shelter, we pasted no mask, no entry. Every taxi, every public transport, no mask, no entry. To create a fear psychosis that if I'm without a mask, I may not be allowed to get into an auto rickshaw. I may not be allowed to get into a bus. I may not be allowed to enter a shop. So, and we had wrapped 4,000 buses of BST with no mask, no entry slogan. So this public awareness campaign also has helped us in a big way. And I really thank the citizens of Mumbai who are far better behaved than citizens of other cities. I must admit that they listen to us. On the day of Diwali, I didn't ban firecrackers. I only made an appeal through a video. I said, please don't burst crackers, although you have permission to burst crackers in your private premises. And that day, I got a WhatsApp message from a leading editor of a print media next morning. He said, Mr. Chahal, yesterday evening, in 406 square kilometers of Mumbai's geographic area. The evening was like a classroom with exam going on, pin drop silence on day of Diwali. This is what I say, the response of people and their responsible behavior. And I am sure we will go from good to better and from better to best as far as COVID appropriate behavior is concerned. We will keep on going further. I think I'll stop here and invite questions, because we have 26 models. I can keep on talking, and I never see, look at a paper, because everything is comes from the heart. And one thing I must tell you, when I held a 5-hour long meeting with my team on the day one, I told them, like, I said, look, last 100 years, nobody got the opportunity to fight this pandemic. And in the next 100 years, none of our successors may get this opportunity. I said, we are chosen by God. I told 120 of the core team. I said, we are chosen by God. We have got such great opportunity to serve mankind, to save human lives. And I said, if look how many people get this opportunity in, say, 200 years, 100 years last, now next 100 years. And we are just few of us, bunch of us who have got this opportunity. And as a municipal commissioner, I'm such a blessed one that in the last 100 years, I'm the only one to get this opportunity. I said, let us make the best of this opportunity and try to save human lives. And later on today, I realized that the kind of happiness, the kind of satisfaction, the kind of psychological satisfaction you get after saving a fellow human's life, it is incomparable and it cannot be described.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
I other day I had an interview with Reuters and AFP. It has gone over the world. I said, look, if somebody can clone my mobile phone, I said, this is my mobile phone. If somebody clones this and takes a copy of this phone, he would find at least 200 WhatsApp messages unknown, which I have still not recorded, that I have not saved their names. The message would be, my father, my brother, my sister, my husband, somebody in my family is dying, sir. We want an urgent ICU bed. We want an oxygen bed. We want a hospital admission. And I had created a system with my team. I said, whenever such message would come, I won't ring up, make any phone call, and nobody should call me. I will forward this WhatsApp to one Mr. Mesh Narvekar, who's our control room head. And he would have dozens of people, dedicated people, and they would make sure that this unknown person's request is heeded to and the bed is allotted to. Because even the worst of time, when we had 93,000 active cases, that day also we have 3,600 vacant beds available to us, including 850 oxygen beds available to us. We had stress in ICUs. We are now adding 800 of them. But we were always at least 3,600 minimum vacancy we had. And I said, this team would allot, the moment somebody sends me a WhatsApp message unknown, I needed bother to know who he is. Justly forwarded it, and in half an hour, 10 minutes, 10, 15 minutes, sometime in 3 minutes, message would come back. Bed is allotted and patient has been informed. Because I would ask the patient, hey, please send patient name, relative name and cell number. This WhatsApp I would send back if he has not already done it. Later on, people started sending it. They knew what the system is. And that would be forwarded so that Mr. Narvekar will load a bed and inform the patient's relative on the cell number. And the message will come to me also. And I'll further forward it back to them. Sometime in 3 to 4 minutes, this exercise would be over. So I told Reuters, I said, if somebody clones my phone, out of this 200 so-called unknown messages, not even one is unanswered. Not even one, your bed has not been allotted. And I said, after that, there's a lull of 10 days, 15 days, 20 days on this particular WhatsApp. Then after 20 days, 25 days, I get a message. He says, sir, today my father is discharged and he's alive.
Very good. Hey, really
so
great.
At least 150 of these messages are with me.
Yes.
Not only this, I have at least 15 messages where a person has replied back after 25 days, 30 days, 21 days, sir, my so-and-so has passed away, but sir, I want to thank you. That helped us. Even somebody's demise also, people are thanking you. So this system which we created in Mumbai, I really say it's a unique of its kind. But now, what is driving us? It is the people who literally motivate us, they encourage us, and we further get galvanized, we further get driven by this thing. And now I tell my team, I look, what I told you on the 8th of May, in those 5 hours, no better satisfaction than saving a human life. And this is it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Chahal.
Wonderful. Only thing I wanted to, the idea of doing the program, and I'm troubling you last 1 year, I know, and you keep on messaging, and I think I'm an evidence to it that you always reply, and even to the everything. I mean, it's not only the patient, and we are getting response all over, and I feel guilty to contact you, but the only reason I'm contacting all the time is I represent thousands of doctors where we want to give you that force to you. Even now, I know a lot of doctors with you, I know all of them, but I'm representing Echo India, even though I'm not actively part, but I'm also representing through All India Ophthalmic Society, then also the Organized Medical Academy. One thing I have a suggestion, which we are already working with BMCs. You are already dealing with diabetic patients and comorbidities like COVID, and also you mentioned about nephrology, how you are working with Dr. Bishley. So similar thing, I think we can do one more thing, which will be the first of its kind in the world, is how can we take care of the diabetic retinopathy, where nobody in Bombay will go blind with our association. And I'm ready to do everything free for BMC, and we will get corporates to support us. We're already having a system which if we can establish in Mumbai, and it can be copied all over the world, which is the same system like iPad, then whatever phone you have, that diabetic patients are getting neglected on their own, not because of the doctors or BMC. They are afraid to come out, and they read this, they wear the mask and do. So I keep recognizing them. We are already doing cleaning all the hospitals in Mumbai, and they should come, because diabetic, I think the BMC is doing a unique program for the last several years. I know we have 55 centers giving free diabetic medicine. So I think apart from COVID, you can also add over once eye checkup. You can use this system of putting to with our group, and along with the BMC doctors, we are ready to serve. And I think I'm actually dumbstruck what to ask you, because I had so many questions, but you have already answered. Maybe Dr. Kumudra is raising his hand.
Your point is well taken. Your point is well taken. I definitely will meet and we'll take it further. But yes, at the same time, right now, I'll like to make an offer to all my eminent audience. You know, we are building now 4 new jumbo hospitals. One in Worli Race Course is a 500 bed with 400 cubical rooms, because experts say that there may be a pediatric wave where a mother may come with a 1-year-old child who's symptomatic COVID positive. So we need privacy. So we are building 1,000 cubicles, 400 in Worli Race Course. There's 500 beds in jumbo in Worli Race Course will have 200 ICU, 400 cubicles, 70% oxygenated beds, and in situ oxygen generation plant. Similarly, we have 2,000 beds in Malad, Jumbo, 1,000 beds in Sion, and 2,000 beds in Kanjur Marg, in Crompton Gibbs compound, all having 200 ICU each, total 804 hospital places. Then 1,000 plus cubicles, every place having its own oxygen generation plant, no movement of oxygen now, it will all be produced there itself. And it'll be absolutely air-conditioned, 5-star complex. So I am issuing expression of interest either tomorrow or by Friday or Monday. Where am I now? I'm inviting a private hospitals or a group of eminent doctors. And we are giving them an offer that you come and take over this jumbo. We'll give you everything. Every equipment, right from ventilators to medicines to any treatment protocol, everything will be provided free of cost. And if you just bring in your staff and whatever for ICU, whatever medical consultation norms are there to run ICU per bed, as per that norms, you do it, because we've already done it. In the earlier 7 jumbos, we have 612 ICU beds. And all 612 ICU beds are outsourced since last September. That is another model. I forgot to mention that. So there, we had issued expression of interest, and group of specialist doctors had joined hands, and they agreed to run these 612 ICU beds at 7 different locations. And we said, we give you all medicines of ICU free. We give you all the equipment free. It will be absolutely ready for you. You just get in your staff and staffing as per MCI guidelines for an ICU. And you please quote what charge you would charge us per bed. So the quote was 7,000 rupees per bed per day with minimum 50% guarantee. Like these days, we don't have patients, but we are paying them 50% guarantee amount. And if you have more than 50%, you get that number of 7,000 rupees per bed. And this has worked very well. And today, like thousands of people have gone through those 612 ICU beds. And not even one staff of BMC is involved there. It is all private doctors groups who took over these ICUs and running them. Now going further, now we are offering the entire jumbo, lock, stock and barrel, to a group of specialist doctors who can join hands. Like Dr. Natarajan can be like a chairperson. He can take some anesthesiists. He can take in some interventionists. He can take some other MBBS doctors. Supposing it has 200 ICU bed, you want to run 100 only, you want to run 50, or you want to run the entire space, you can form your team and you can join hands with some hospital also. Like I have been telling today morning, I went to Breach Candy. I said, why don't you take one jumbo hospital? Even they are working on it. And then we say that there's an extension of that hospital. Supposing you join hands with a Fortis and you take Kanjurmarg. So we'll say this is extended Fortis hospital. Supposing Breach Candy, Bombay Hospital takes Worli Jumbo, we'll say this is extended Bombay Hospital, extended Breach Candy. So this experiment we're trying for two reasons. Number one, citizens get the best of the treatments. And number two, this culture in the country, that everybody wants a private hospital, come what may. They would rather go to a 20-bed nursing home, private, rather than coming to air-conditioned jumbo with 200 ICU. So this will also reassure them that the 6,500-bed, 800 ICU, it is run by professionals from private hospitals or a group of private expert doctors. So they will also be lured by a ward war room to go to these places. So you can think of joining hands either at your own level or through one of these 35 major hospitals, and we will give you this entire jumbo to run.
Over to you, Dr. Rai.
Mr. Chahal, yes, on behalf of Echo India, and all of us 350 plus who were here today, let me compliment you on a very passionate presentation. I think it's the passion which with what you have done and the way you were speaking about it, it brought tears in my eyes. So honestly, to have done so much, to have so much of clear-sightedness and to carry everyone along is truly phenomenal. I have a couple of submissions. One is that let your experience be published in an international scientific journal. Sir, it is all very good that it is published in newspaper and the world over. And I think Dr. Natarajan and Dr. Sandeep Balla are already doing it. Secondly, if you will permit me, I will take 1 minute about Echo India. We are a charitable trust and we are in the business, if I call you, for skilling the workforce. In the COVID wave, we have trained over 400,000 people across the country. Of course, this is a very minuscule amount. We offer our services to BMC, to you, that if any skilling is required for any of these people, because as you are saying, with so many facilities, some of the lower workforce may require some skilling. We offer our model free of cost, gratis. We have never charged anybody a penny, and we would like to offer that. But above all, my compliments to you for bringing equity in a manner where probably nowhere it has been brought in a low middle income country. And to that extent, I wish this kind of video is compulsory learning for every Indian citizen so that they know that what committed person can do. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
So I think sir's appeal to us from Echo India, we have so many thousand doctors part of Echo India. Plus myself, I will also work on this homework which he has given, which is a real good homework for me to do. I always ask Mr. Chahal, what can I do to support BMC? So anyway, even though I'm an eye doctor, but still running the ICU and is important right now. As sir said about diabetes, we'll do later. But I will think about it, sir. It's a great thing. You've given a good homework for me, which I will talk to all the various presidents and various societies apart from the hospitals, which you are already talking. We'll come back to you. And you said you're going to send that interest notice tomorrow or something like that, right?
Yes. Maybe by Friday or Monday, we'll issue their expression of interest and we'll invite group of doctors or private hospitals to take over our jumbo, lock, stock and barrel, where we'll give you everything. We'll give you all medicines. We'll give you all equipment. Right. We'll bear all catering, housekeeping, backup, generator backups, dewatering pump, everything we'll do. You have just had to get manpower, run it, and you can charge per bed whatever you quote.
Okay. But sir, so just I hope we'll grab it as an email, sir, so that I'll work on it, because I'm the immediate past president of organized medicine, medicine academical. We have about 150,000 doctors all over the country. So we can work with the Dr. Ishwar Gilada, the secretary of AIDS Society, where we'll work with him and come, because we are in Mumbai. So we have to come with the Mumbai doctors to you. So can I get it by email, sir? So that
I will. And you know, like the past experience from last September till almost this June now, where a group of specialist doctors following the MCM norms of ICUs, they're running this 612 ICU on jumbos successfully in the last almost 9 months. And they have treated thousands of people, where BMC need not worry about a specialist or a interventionist or a anesthesiologist to fend for, because we were short of these specialist doctors. But just imagine, like a BKC, we had for the last 4 months, we had 108 ICU beds and they'll all be full. So every evening you get roughly for 100 beds and 7,000 per bed, so you get about 7 lakhs per day. We are paying almost 2 crores per month. And this was highly viable to those group of doctors who joined hands. And it was win-win for everybody. And many of the doctors were sitting home in this lockdown with their small clinics closed. Even they got good income, medium and plus service to humanity.
Sir, Echo India is planning to launch a skilling program for 5,000 nurses in the state of Maharashtra. And this will be purely, as I said, gratis. And we would just need your support. These nurses would be supported in the infectious disease training of COVID and non-COVID diseases. And we have...
Right, sir, I assure you that you will not find us lacking, wanting. We will be too happy to assist you.
Sir, it will be our privilege to support such a noble mission in Maharashtra. By the way, sir, I trained in Maharashtra. I am an alumni of Armed Forces Medical College. I served for 28 years in the army. And Maharashtra is very close to my heart. And I'm really proud. I consider myself half Maharashtrian. I have not had the privilege of serving like you in Maharashtra. But it's a wonderful state to be in. And if Echo India can do something to support your initiative, your support state, we'll be very happy to do that.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Chahal sir, for elaborating your the story of fight in Mumbai regarding combating COVID-19. There are a lot of questions and the time is very short, sir. I will take just one or two questions. There is a question from one of the eminent person from Kolkata Municipal Corporation. This is the corporation we have done the MOU with them. And Dr. T.K. Mukherjee is the chief advisor there. Between home and hospital, do you find any place for oxygen parlor for COVID positive cases? That is the question to you, sir. Do you?
Well, you know, in Mumbai, we never had that issue, because if you see that we had a very exhaustive SOPs for oxygen management in Mumbai. And in that, if with this kind of management, the parlors are just not required. For example, in Mumbai, we handled 93,000 actives with just about 235 metric ton of oxygen. And the number one was, in this oxygen management model, we had, first of all, our 2,000 suspected beds are all oxygen parlors only. If you see, right now, 2,000 beds are lying available to patients. They can take auto rickshaw. And they are all in air-conditioned environment with central Wi-Fi facilities, and with each manned by a dean who's the rank of a principal of a medical college. And he has all put together 2,000 beds. So each bed is like an oxygen parlor. You come there, you have walk-in entry. There is no denial. You only put an oxygen. That is as good as a parlor. It is like saying that we have 2,000 parlors already functioning. And besides that, the way our oxygen management model has been framed, like emergency stocks in every nook and corner of the city, in 3 to 5 minutes on SOS call, the tanker or the cylinder starts moving. Then strict enforcement that no private hospital will increase their oxygenated beds beyond their turnaround time of 24 hours and disturb the 24 hours. Because we have so many jumbos, we never pressurized private hospital to increase their oxygenated beds. It happened once with the Parsi hospital that without our knowledge, they it's a 120 bed hospital and their turnaround time for oxygen consumption, if they have more than 40 beds occupied with oxygenated beds, then their 24 hour turnaround time gets disturbed. So on a particular day, they put 96 patients on oxygen. And in 11 hours, the oxygen started getting exhausted. And these big companies like Inox, Linde, they won't come to your door twice a day. They will come only once in a day with the cylinders or your oxygen tank. So at 11:30, they started sending SOS that in next 1 hour, if oxygen doesn't come, these 96 patients can die. They are on all oxygen. But we had a system in place. Like we had created a system that if any SOS call comes from any quarter to MC or additional MC or joint MC or deputy municipal commissioner, single point forwarding to ward officer. And he single point forwarding to a particular deputy commissioner. There's 6 emergency stock points, 50 tons of oxygen lying available all the time. And the moment this the ward service forwarded to the deputy commissioner in charge of one of the 6 stocking points, each heading 4 wards, the tanker starts moving in 3 to 5 minutes. And in 20 minutes, you have to reach that particular hospital. So when we reached that hospital within 20 minutes, the next morning I was very upset. I said, look, we have plenty of oxygen. And how they are sending SOS calls. Then we found that they increased their beds from 40 to 96, disturbed their 24-hour turnaround time to 11 hours. Then we have passed an order that no private hospital, 142 of them, shall increase even one single oxygen bed extra without our knowledge and create solve one problem by creating another problem. This has happened in many cities of the country where when patients were seen lying on the floors, 2 patients lying on one bed, the administration put a lot of pressure and told the hospital to increase their oxygenated beds. And that led to disturbance of turnaround time and patients started dying, oxygen exhausted. Despite the fact that it was not a case of oxygen shortage, it was a case of sheer mismanagement of oxygen. Because if tomorrow, if I have a hospital, I have 100 beds and I have only 20 oxygen beds, I make 100 out of 100 oxygen beds, my patient will die because I don't have that storage. Unless I increase my storage also, which is cannot happen overnight, this mismatch is dangerous. And this is exactly what I believe it happened in many hospitals. Unfortunately, look at Goa, 83 people have been alleged to have died because of no oxygen in a small town of 15 lakh population only. So this is unfortunate. So then we went to our state task force. We told them, tell us how to conserve oxygen. So they gave us a couple of points. They said, maintain oxygen or saturation level at 94 only. Don't take it to 98. Nobody is going to die at 94, 95 oxygen level. This saved 10% oxygen. Just this one single correction. Then they told us, then we told the private hospitals that you do your audit. How much you are consuming last week, how much this year, this week. You come to know whether technicians are making some mistake or some leakage is happening somewhere. You start auditing your oxygen. Then we say that this high flow nasal oxygen guzzler, I said, don't use it as a routine. Use only wherever it is already required. This also, these small steps led to saving a lot of oxygen. So, and then we said, right from the time the tanker leaves a Jamnagar plant or a Jindal plant, it should be crystal clear whose tanker it is, whether it is BMC or Navi Mumbai or Thane or Jalgaon. There should not be any fight. It should not be a tanker coming to MMR area. There will be a lot of chaos there. And secondly, the moment tanker comes in our custody, the moment from our custody to 182 hospitals, there has to be properly streamlined. There have to be nodal officers guiding this. Then movement. The hospital cylinders or tanks are filled up. This management within the hospital, keep your oxygenated beds to a level where you maintain your 24-hour turnaround time. Then after that, you maintain emergency stock points, but still somebody is going to misbehave, somebody is going to have some leakage somewhere, he's going to give some excuse why oxygen ran out, he'll say, I had big leakage, that's why my oxygen ran out. Then you have emergency stocking, you reach them in 15-20 minutes on an auto mode. And then finally, oxygen audit and ways to save oxygen. So all these processes really helped us. And I can proudly say that in 400,000 people in Mumbai who were COVID positive in the second wave, the electronic media didn't get even a single excuse to even click one picture of anybody roaming around with a cylinder on an auto rickshaw or sitting on a street or sitting on a footpath with the auto rickshaw or with a cylinder on or any such news item that somebody is buying oxygen cylinder. In Mumbai, it was not even a single such picture which I saw.
Sir, any precaution, what is that we are going to do for third wave? Because people are telling it will come, whatever you do. What is
I always say I'm not an expert. We have a state expert task force now, two of them. One pediatrics task force at state level and one earlier task force under Dr. Sanjay Oak, Dr. Udwadia, Dr. Shant Joshi, Dr. Rahul Pandit. They have been advising us. And that's a very good thing which Honorable CMs have created. That's a real technical backup which I have 24/7 with me, available to me. They define patient treatment protocols. They help us audit oxygen and things like that. That's a wonderful way of handling things. Now, our pediatric task force has been created. They have already defined to us the patient treatment protocol for a pediatric case, home quarantine or in hospital. We are building four jumbos, primarily pediatric jumbos. We are making 1,000 cubicles for the mother and child to be comfortable there in privacy. Then we have already started procuring certain medicines which would maybe required later on. They're never available. You have to catch them early. These the stocks. Then Honorable CM sir, few days back took a Zoom meeting of 2 hours of 662 pediatric doctors of Maharashtra state. And this our task force doctors, they groomed them, they addressed them, they sanitized them with a further request that they should sanitize and they should train the family physicians in every nook and corner of the state. Then we started last 15 days at ward level, physical meetings. One of the doctors from the pediatric task force comes and he addresses a group of family physicians and pediatricians of that area and ward, and they tell them about the various facets of how to face the pediatric wave it comes. So this exercise is going on, and by end of this month, we'll make sure that every family doctor is trained, sanitized, and sensitized with how to handle this pediatric wave if it comes. So we always say that like plan for the worst and think of the best. Pray for the best.
Great, sir. I think if you see that the Mumbai model of the fight against COVID pandemic is unique of its kind in the world itself. And I will narrate your mantra, sir, only that if you want to achieve anything in your life, make your own goals and work hard. And this is the mantra by which you have worked with your team and you have led this team. But ultimately, the leaders, it depends upon the leader how he's leading the team. And we are really grateful and thankful to you that the way you are leading this battle of COVID-19 and from the front for Mumbai makers, and I think the people of the Mumbai colleagues, I think they have realized the importance of how they want to save themselves. I think if you go up, we don't grow when things are easy, but we all grow when we have challenges. This is a challenging time for all of us. And tough situations do not last, sir, but tough people do. And you are one of the toughest people. People like you. We need people like you. We need leaders like you to roll these type of battles, to lead the show. On behalf of Eco India Extension for Community Health Outcome, we are really grateful and thankful to you that you have given us ample of time and you have narrated the story of a Mumbai model, which is really an eye-opener and learning for so many of all of us. And we are very grateful that if we can get an opportunity to work under your leadership, even a minuscule movement, it will be a great honor that we will do something in collaboration with you. On behalf of Eco India whole family, I'm really humbly thankful. Thanks to Dr. Natarajan, thanks to Dr. Kumudrai, and thanks to all the colleagues on behalf of my executive director, Dr. Sunil Ananda also, and my whole Eco family. We are really grateful to you. And we are also thankful to SBI Foundation for giving us this gracious grant to continue this
education. Sir, one point I would like to mention, I'm sorry to interrupt you. In the second wave, which came started on 10th of February, we have 4.02 lakh cumulative COVID positive cases which came in the second wave, and our mortality is 3,605 till today. This works out to roughly 0.85%, and I always claim that 0.8% means that for every 1,000 people who became COVID positive, 992 could survive. And with sense of great humility and pride, I always claim that this is one of the best anywhere in the world.
Great. Sir, we should thank you and the Chief Minister of Maharashtra and the entire Maharashtra for this. Jai Maharashtra, sir. Thank you. I think really
Thank you, sir.
And I think we are here to only say we want to work with you, and you know me very well. So I'm going to be with you, and we'll do that. And on behalf of Eco India, we are already, thanks for us, Mr. Chandrasekhar Chore, you have given us all the documents. We have one, Dr. Divya Singh, Dr. Sandeep, and other public health people. We are working on it. We already downloaded what to be done for Lancet. So Mr. Dr. Sandeep has given a guidance that we will take your all the approval, then only we'll start writing. Then sure. Only we will take your approval, and we will, you as the main person for the paper, and publish in Lancet, as Dr. Kumudrai said.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Mr. Chahal.
All the best, sir. Take care, sir.
Thank you, sir.
I'll just take one minute more. Can I please request all the participants to kindly, respond to the feedback link. Thank you once again, Mr. Chahal, Dr. Kumudrai, Professor you. Dr. S. Natarajan, Dr. Sandeep Bhalla, and everybody, especially the participants who have been here. We are just sharing the screen, and I think it in itself is a very big thing for us. So can I please request the IT team, Soham and Manjeet, to please share the next session that we are having, which is on the 18th of June. So I would request all the participants to kindly log in, which will be done by Dr. Colonel Rakesh Verma, and the topic is operating healthcare facilities during pandemic and beyond. Thank you so much, everyone, and wish you everyone good health and good night. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Many people want to listen to you again. Fortunately, we have done a YouTube live. I'll send you all the links. Thanks to Dr. Sandeepala and the team. And also from our side, we have done. So a lot of people have written in there. I think that they're impressed with the leadership. There are some questions which I've taken photographs, and I will send it to you, and we'll answer them. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Baba. Thank you,
everyone. Good night.
Good night.